Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to It's Rainmaking Time. This is Kim Greenhouse. It gives me great pleasure to welcome John Olagues to the show today. He is the owner and principal consultant for Options for Employees. He's a recognized authority in areas that are very complex to most of us. He's going to illuminate them. He began as a pension consultant. He's been an investment advisor, a stockbroker. And upon reading Ed Thorpe's books, Beat the Deal and Beat the Market, he became a market maker in options and a trader in San Francisco. He became involved in employee stock options in 2005. This is a market maker and an experienced professional who understands this entire realm. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome John Olagues to It's Rainmaking Time. Good afternoon.
Thank you, Kim, for that very nice introduction, and I'm happy to be here, and I hope we'll have a nice conversation.
Well, I'm looking forward to it. Let me tell you how I heard about you.
All right.
I was at a GATA conference, a gold antitrust action committee conference several years ago in Washington, D.C., actually in Virginia, and I was having dinner and talking to this gentleman, and he started to talk about you, and the next morning handed me an article by Rob Kirby called A National Disaster. I had never heard anybody who had your kind of experience who talked about the kind of things that you talked about, like the massive buying of puts and the shorting stock in Bear Stearns, about how Bear Stearns' stock was artificially collapsed so that insider traders would make billions and J.P. Morgan would be paid $55 billion U.S. tax dollars to shore themselves up and to buy Bear Stearns at bankruptcy prices. I felt that that was uncommon. It's not all of what you're about because you have so much experience, but I thought it would be useful to call upon an inside person who has the training and experience and the knowledge who could bring us in to what is happening and to make very clear to us what is the value of having employee stock options in a scenario where we don't really know what the executives are doing anymore, and there's been shenanigans in this area of employee stock options, which I know you're going to talk about all the different sides of it. So please talk about whatever you'd like to share with us right now.
All right, Kim. In 1976, I became what they call an options market maker on the Pacific Stock Exchange floor in San Francisco. I did that for 5 years, and what we did was we traded puts and calls, and what I used was theoretical pricing models to determine which one was the underpriced and which one was the overpriced, and we would buy the one we thought was the right one to buy, and we'd sell the others and do hedges and things like that. So I did that for 5 years there. Now, that was shortly after the Chicago Board Options Exchange in Chicago started, which was the first secondary market in traded options. That was created in Chicago and started in 1973. And right around that time, there was the creation of the Black-Scholes pricing model, which Myron Scholes and Fisher Black and a fellow by the name of Merton won the Nobel Prize for the Black-Scholes theoretical pricing model. So we were in the beginning there, and I had a little background in math because I had a degree from Tulane, and I had some experience as a stockbroker and an investment advisor. And so I started to be pretty good at trading on the floor, although things were new in those days. And what the facts were is that very few of the traders understood anything about theoretical pricing models, and I and my good friend Blair Hull, we actually started a little company called Options Research where we provided theoretical pricing models to the public and other market makers. But that was started in 76. I stayed there for 4 or 5 years and I hired a few little people, and some of them went up to Chicago. You know, I went up there too because the game was bigger in Chicago. A lot of these market makers got their early stake playing blackjack and following Ed Thorpe's Beat the Dealer strategy, and he wrote another book called Beat the Market, you know, so they were all related. And I know I listened to Ed Thorpe on your site or one of the related sites.
Oh, you listened to Scott Patterson, who wrote The Quants? He was one of the people he interviewed.
Right, right. That goes back to 1969 and even maybe a year or two before. So that's a long time ago. But anyway, I went up to Chicago and traded there for a good while. as a market maker trading options, you're right in the midst of things as far as insider trading that takes place, because that's where they go first with to cheat with their inside information. They go through the options, okay, because it used to be the case that when a guy abused the insider trading rules, he might have gone to jail, and there was guys like Boesky and Milken and Levine and people like that in those days where the SEC found that they were insider trading, arrested them, and threw them in jail. They don't do that anymore, okay? But anyway, I had experience of being on the floor at that time when guys like that were coming in and doing insider trading.
I want to bring you back for just a minute because I know you're going to be on a roll right now. First of all, I want you to explain to the public what a market maker does.
Well, a market maker stands on the floor. At least in those days, we stood on the floor and made bids and offers for puts and calls. A put is the right to sell the stock, and a call is the right to buy the stock at a specific price throughout a specific period of time. So if I thought the stock was going to go up, you know, I would buy some calls because those were like substitutes for buying the stock. Instead of buying the stock, you might say, well, I'll buy some calls, which gives me the right to buy the stock. And if the stock goes up, my calls get worth more. And so anyway, we made markets. In other words, when I say make a market, I mean stand on the floor and stand ready to do buying and selling at a reasonably tight bid and offer, okay? Now, a lot of that's electronic these days, and the actual physical floors have been eliminated to a large degree.
Do you think that's good or not good?
Well, it's not good for the market makers who used to trade like I used to and others. We had a chance of making a good bit of money because now it's dominated by, I call it the Walmarts of the securities industry. You know, they've knocked out of business all the little guys who are market makers, and it's just Goldman, J.P. Morgan, Citigroup, and, specialist firms who have billions of dollars and no limit as to how much they can buy or how much they can sell. And they also, in my view, generally trade on inside information, however they get it.
What makes a good market maker?
Well, I was tall and I could shout loud, and I guess I had a degree in math, so I had a little understanding of statistics and theoretical values and how they create those things, and just some experience in the business, and a guy maybe that had some experience under pressure. Actually, I think I was like the ideal market maker, but I was a little impatient. But anyway, there was times when you could make a lot of money trading as a market maker, and of course, there were people that made a lot of money and then lost a lot of money. They didn't really understand all the risks they were taking. I don't really want to get into that because it's going to take too long and I think it might be too esoteric.
So let's go back to employee stock options. What made you go into employee stock options and what's your experience right now in that arena?
Okay, well, supposedly there's 10 million people out in the United States alone that have employee stock options that were granted to them by the companies they work for. There's a large portion of those people that are in California, in Silicon Valley, okay? Now, what happens is that the companies essentially contract with the managers and the other employees and all the way up to the top executives, the CEO. They contract with them to give them employee stock options in lieu of cash compensation or for a reduced amount of cash compensation. So when you hear about all of these executives getting all of these large payoffs, it's not because they're just giving them a bunch of cash. It's because they're giving them employee stock options mostly, or what they call SARs, or stock appreciation rights, or they give them restricted stock. There's a compensation committee, which is part of the board of directors, that grant these equity compensation products. And it ends up by people that work for example, Apple or Cisco or Google or Qualcomm. They'll end up by having a load of either options, that is, employee stock options. They'll have restricted stock, and they'll have they might even have some stock in a pension plan or an IRA or stuff like that. So when we're talking about employee stock options,